In this class, we will see the development of the cardiovascular system. Cardiovascular system is a part of the circulatory system. Why there is the need of the circulatory system or the cardiovascular system in the embryo? In the beginning, if you see, just after ovulation, the nourishment of the embryo is by the cytoplasm of the ovum. Then after that, when this ovum, fertilized ovum reaches the uterine cavity, how it is nourished? How it is nourished? It is nourished by the secretion of the uterine glands in the uterine cavity. Then the implantation of the zygote starts at the 7th day. So the implanted embryo now can derive its nutrition from the eroded endometrial wall of the uterus. So like this, the nourishment of the embryo in the beginning starts. Then by the second week, with the advent of the lacunar spaces in the syncytial trophoblast, there is a need for establishing the uteroplacental circulation. The maternal blood reaches these lacunae and nourishes the embryo. How this maternal blood reaches the embryonic disc in the first 2 weeks of development? By the diffusion through the amnia, extraembryonic cellulose, primary and the secondary yolk sac. But this system of indirect nutrition of the embryo by the way of diffusion cannot satisfy the needs of the human embryo. So this necessitates the development of the cardiovascular system or the blood vascular systems during the third week. First, this blood vascular system starts in the extraembryonic part of the embryo, then the intraembryonic part of the embryo. So this explains there is the need for the circulatory system or the cardiovascular system, as there is by this way of diffusion, the nourishment is not enough for the embryos. As the embryo is fastly growing, it needs its own circulatory system that will be starting in the beginning of the third week in the extra embryonic part of the embryo. How this blood vascular system, which layer will contribute to this blood vascular system? Can anybody tell? It is from the mesenchyme, angiogenic mesenchyme. This angioblast cells, first they group as blood islands. Then the spaces appear in this blood island so that the separated central part of the blood cells, they will be persisting as the future blood cells of the embryo. And the peripheral angioblast cells will be contributing to the endothelium of the vessels. So this circulatory system starts from the angioblast cells so that these plexus of network of capillary vessels appear, then they sprout, then they establish communication with each other. Like this, the beginning of the circulatory system. So that I think that explains the beginning of the circulatory system for you, I hope. Now, the blood circulatory system or the blood vascular system in the extra embryonic part of the embryo starts in the early part of the third week. So this is, you should remember, only extra embryonic is beginning in the early part of the third week. In the wall of the yolk sac, it will be called as the vitelline vessels. In the connecting stalk and the chorion, it will be called as the umbilical vessels. Development of intraembryonic blood vascular system. They develop in the later part of the third week. They develop again from the angioblast cells of the intraembryonic mesoderm. They can now establish secondary connections with the extraembryonic blood vessels. So beginning, extraembryonic blood vessels start. Then in the later part of the third week, intraembryonic blood vessels also develop. If you see this, primitive heart or the beginning of the circulatory system of the embryo, we can see two longitudinal vessels that will be called as the dorsal aorta. They appear on each side of the notochord along the dorsal wall of the yolk sac. At the cephalic end, they will be invading the cardiogenic area as the lateral endothelial heart tubes. So if you see in this embryo, the beginning of the development of the heart development, first we will be telling in relation before the foldings of the embryo, then after the foldings of the embryo. So can anyone tell when the foldings of the embryo, in which week starts? Yes, it is fourth week of the embryo. So before that third week, the vascular system starts developing. So we should see in relation of the system before the foldings and after the foldings of the embryo. So before the foldings, the dorsal aorta is invading this cardiogenic area as the lateral endothelial heart tubes. So this is the beginning of the formation of the dorsal aorta on each side of the notochord. If you see, it is the cephalic end of the embryo. So this picture demonstrates the embryo before the development of the foldings of the embryo. So if this dorsal aorta is invading this cardiogenic area, then if it is invading the cardiogenic area, it will be called as the endothelial heart tubes. It is in relation to the pericardial cavity already formed. It is separated from this pericardial cavity by the myoepicardial mantle that will be forming the future myocardium of the heart. So this myoepicardial mantle is derived from the mesoderm of the embryo. So this, if you observe the all the three images, that shows how this foldings of the embryo is changing this relation of the heart tube with the embryo. So this is in the beginning, it is the in the cephalic end septum transversum, then the pericardial cavity and the endothelial heart tubes, then will be the stromodium. So the head fold is changing or reversal of the cardiovascular system in relation to the embryo, so that this cranial folding or head folding has moved this heart tube and the pericardial cavity ventrally and caudally. So this is the after the head fold of the embryo, you can see this is the cranial end, forebrain vesicle, stromodium, then will be the heart tubes and the pericardial cavity. So this now after the foldings of the embryo, the pericardial cavity and the heart tubes has reversed its surfaces in relation to the yolk sac. The cardiogenic area after foldings of the embryo will be bounded by the ventrally by the pericardial sac, dorsally by the foregut, cephalic side by the stromodium, caudal side by the septum transversum. I think we will understand this relations in the next image. So this is what I was explaining previously. Before the folding of the embryo, this cranial end will be occupied by the septum transversum. Then this is the cardiogenic area. Now the invading of the heart the endothelial heart tubes and the pericardial cavity, and this is the stromodium. So after this formation of the head folds of the embryo, it has changed this heart tube and the pericardial cavity has changed its relationships, so that it is related to ventrally to the foregut and then dorsally to the yolk sac. This is the yolk sac dorsally, and cranially stromodium, and caudally this is the septum transversum. So I think you have understood now after the foldings of the embryo, the heart tube relations and the pericardial cavity relationships. So this, so after this cephalic and lateral foldings and the tail foldings of the embryo, these foldings of the embryo bring the two endothelial heart tubes closer, so that they will meet and fuse, and the craniocaudal direction to form a single primitive heart tube. Now this will be called as the definitive heart. The cranial end of the tube will be called as the arterial end, and the caudal end will be called as the venous end. So this is the fusion of the two endothelial heart tubes. It happens in the craniocaudal direction, so that the cranial end will be called as the arterial end and the caudal end will be called as the venous end. In the previous slide, we told what is the relation of the caudal relation of the heart tube, septum transversum. So you can see in this image, the caudal end of the heart tube is in related to the septum transversum, which will be giving rise to the liver and diaphragm in the future. So after this formation of the single tube, there is appearing constrictions and dilatations, so that this single tube is divided into some parts. What are these parts? If you see from the cranial end to the caudal end, bulbous caudis, primitive ventricle, primitive atrium, and sinus venosus. So the constriction between the bulbous caudis and the primitive ventricle is the first constriction to appear. Then the remaining constrictions and dilatations appear. So these are the parts of the definitive heart, four parts, from cranial to the caudal direction. So what is lying at the arterial end or cranial end? The bulbous caudis. The bulbous caudis initially is showing as a single dilatation. If you see sometimes later, this shows three parts. It is proximal part, which will give rise to the inflow, trabeculated inflow tract of the right ventricle. The middle part will be called as the conus caudis, and the distal part or the cephalic part will be called as the truncus arteriosus. So there are three parts of the bulbous caudis: proximal part, trabeculated part, middle part, conus caudis, and the distal part will be called as the truncus arteriosus. So the definitive heart has appeared by the fusion of the two endothelial heart tubes, and this definitive heart has presented now with the four constrictions and four parts by the constrictions. So this is the heart starts beating by the 22nd day of the embryo, and it is the first organ to start functioning, and it is proved that the blood passes through this primitive and the definitive heart by the 24th day of the embryo. So the definitive heart, what is at the cephalic end, we have seen that is the bulbous caudis, and there are three parts of the bulbous caudis. What is at the caudal end of the definitive heart? Venous end. What is the venous end? Sinus venosus. Sinus venosus has two horns, right horn and the left horn in the beginning. We have seen in the previous images, sinus horn is, venosus is related to the septum transversum. So this horn, right horn and left horn, receives the veins which are passing through this septum transversum. They are the, on two sides, vitelline veins and the umbilical veins. And this horn also receives the common cardinal vein. What is this common cardinal vein? Common cardinal vein is related to the embryo or body stock of the embryo. And this vitelline vein will be related to the yolk sac, and umbilical vein will be related to the connecting stock of the embryo. The cardinal vein is related to mainly to the body wall of the embryo. So this common cardinal vein will be formed by the fusion of anterior cardinal vein and the posterior. So this common cardinal vein will be formed by the fusion of anterior cardinal vein and the posterior cardinal vein. Anterior cardinal vein will receive from the cephalic end of the embryo, and the posterior cardinal vein will receive the venous drainage from the caudal parts of the embryo. They fuse to form the common caudinal vein. So this common caudinal vein will be called as the now duct of Cuvier. So we have seen still now what are the steps in this development of the cardiovascular system. We have seen in the vessels develop in the extra embryonic part of the embryo in the early part of the third week. In the later part of the third week, intra embryonic blood vessels start. They are called as the dorsal aorta. They invade the cardiogenic region, that will be the beginning of the lateral endothelial heart tubes. When they fuse and form the primitive heart, then they showed the constrictions and dilatations so that they are divided into parts: bulbous caudis, primitive ventricle, primitive atrium, sinus, venosus. So the bulbous caudis will be at the arterial end and sinus venosus will be at the venous end. So still now we have seen all these steps in the development of the cardiovascular system. Now the important step is going to happen now. What is that? Formation of the cardiac loop. It starts at the fourth week of the embryo. What is this formation of the cardiac loop? This longitudinally placed sacculated heart, it is now having sacculations, grows rapidly in related to the pericardium in a limited space. So it is not able to adjust itself so that it forms one loop that will be called as the cardiac loop. How this loop is happening, in which direction it is happening? The tubular heart bulges ventrally and caudally into the pericardial sac in the U-shaped manner. So this direction of this looping is ventrally and caudally into the pericardial sac. What are the parts of this heart tube which is undergoing this cardiac loop? If you see, mainly the bulbous caudis and the primitive ventricle. So these are the main two parts which are undergoing this looping. So this picture shows the definitive heart before this cardiac looping, and this after fourth week, how the heart has looped itself so that it is now almost similar to the configuration of the adult heart. So this three images, if you watch carefully, it is showing how this heart tube or definitive heart is undergoing cardiac looping, otherwise folding and rotation of the heart tube. So you try to see in the image what are the parts from the cephalic to the caudal end. This black color represents the truncus arteriosus. Green color bulbous caudis, and this blue color will be the primitive ventricle. Next will be the red color atrium and the sinus venosus. This truncus arteriosus will be continuous in the later stages with the aortic arch arteries. I think now we have revised this pharyngeal arch arteries. So this aortic arch arteries are the pharyngeal arch arteries. Through this pharyngeal arches, they will be continuous with the dorsal aorta. So these are the parts of this heart tube. Now you see the heart tube is undergoing folding. How it is, this dotted lines represents the pericardial sac. Are you following? This dotted lines represents the pericardial sac. So I have told how this is going to loop ventrally and somewhat caudally. So that is the direction of the cardiac looping, ventrally, so ventrally and caudally into the pericardial sac. So that main parts which are forming the loop will be the bulbous caudis and the primitive ventricle. So this is the bulbous caudis and this will be the primitive ventricle. So these two arrows represents the movement of the parts of the definitive heart which is undergoing the cardiac loop. ventricle moves ventrally and to the right. So this is the ventricle moves ventrally and to the right. Atria moves dorsally and to the left. So that atrium is going behind this cardiac looping. So the cardiac loop in the ventral part will be presenting only the bulbous caudis and the primitive ventricle. The ridge between the bulbous caudis and primitive ventricle will be disappearing, so that it will form as a one cavity, that will be the bulboventricular cavity in the front. Then this primitive atrium will be dorsal to this bulboventricular loop, and still dorsal to that will be the sinus venosus. So we have completed still now formation of the primitive heart, formation of the definitive heart, and the cardiac looping. So that what are the parts of this what are the parts of this definitive heart which are going to form the loop, and what are the directions of this looping, also we have seen in the detail in still now. Now we will start with the changes in the interior of the heart. So this changes in the interior of the heart takes place from the starting of the 5th week to the 8th week. What are the changes in the interior of the heart should take place? What are the parts of this definitive heart now we are having? Anyone can tell? Yes, bulbous caudis, primitive ventricle, primitive atrium, and sinus venosus. What are the parts of the adult heart? Right ventricle, left ventricle, right atrium, left atrium. So in this, if you compare now the embryonic parts and the adult parts, what will be giving rise to these ventricles and what will be giving rise to the parts of the atrium in the adult heart? Bulbous caudis and primitive ventricle, now which has formed as the bulboventricular cavity, that is going to give rise to the right and the left ventricles. Primitive atrium and the sinus venosus will give rise to the right and the left atrium. So these are the changes which should happen in the interior of the heart so that the adult heart configuration will be achieved. So to start with, we will start with the part of the embryonic heart, sinus venosus, then we will see the primitive atrium, then we will see the primitive ventricle. So the beginning of the part which we are taking is the sinus venosus. What happens in this sinus venosus? The sinus venosus, where it is present now after the formation of the bulboventricular loop? Can anyone tell? It has now come to the dorsocaudal side of the primitive atrium. So it has been the now it has come to the most dorsal side of the definitive heart, and also it is dorsal to the primitive atrium. What are the parts in the sinus venosus? In the earlier part we have seen it represents right and left arms only. Now this cardiac looping has happened, so it has occupied dorsal to the primitive atrium, and it is presenting further parts as if it has a body which has a roof, floor, and it has right and left arms. We have already seen each arm will receive the corresponding common cardinal wave. So what are the parts of the sinus venosus? It has a body which has a roof and floor. And what will be the ventral to the sinus venosus? Primitive atrium. So what is now present in the floor of the sinus? Floor of the sinus receives the pair of the umbilical veins and the pair of the vitelline veins. Horns receive the common cardinal veins. So students should now understand the difference. In the beginning of the definitive heart, we told each horn receives all the three veins. Now it has changed. The floor of the sinus is receiving the pair of the umbilical veins and the pair of the vitelline veins. And the horns are only receiving the cardinal veins. And Ventrally, the sinus venosus communicates with the atrium through the sinoatrial orifice. So it is in between the sinus venosus and primitive atrium. What will be the name of the orifice? Will be the sinoatrial orifice. The sinoatrial orifice has the two valves, right and left venous valves, so that they will be projecting into the interior of the primitive atrium. So these are the parts of the definitive heart which we have seen already. Truncus arteriosus, bulbus caudis will be now differentiating into truncus arteriosus, conus caudis, and one more part which is not given in this diagram is the proximal trabeculated part. So these are the three parts of the bulbus caudis. Next will be the primitive ventricle, primitive atrium, and this will be the sinus venosus. This is the beginning of the definitive heart before the cardiac loop. So this cardinal veins, umbilical veins, vitelline veins, all these veins are reaching the sinus venosus. So these umbilical veins and vitelline veins will be passing through the septum transversum. So we have seen in the development of the liver, septum transversum will be transforming into the mainly into the liver endoderm, liver endothel, sorry, liver cells. So which is mainly derived from this this liver endodermal bud, which will be passing through the septum transversum, so that this liver endoderm will be giving rise to the liver cells. Septum transversum will be giving rise to the connective tissue of the liver. Broken vitelline veins and umbilical veins will form the sinus veno, that is the sinusoids of the liver. So that is the relation of the umbilical veins, vitelline veins. They pass through the septum transversum, that will be giving rise to the connective tissue of the liver. And these cardinal veins are received by the horn of the sinus venosus. So still now, these are the veins which are draining into the sinus venosus, but there is a some changes in this veins which are draining into the sinus venosus, and this changes which we will be seeing in detail in the development of the veins in the venous system class. For time being, we will take that at some time all this left side blood which is reaching the left horn of the venous sinuses, left veins, they are regressing, so that the right horn is enlarging and it is the main part which is present now in the sinus venosus. I think I am clear. For time being, we should take, there are some changes in this venous system developing which we are now not dealing in this class. We will see in the development of the venous system class. So now what is the change occurred? Can anyone tell? The right horn of the sinus venosus enlarges. Left horn and the body of the sinus venosus diminishes in size. What is the cause? There is some change in the veins which are draining into this sinus venosus. So the right horn of the sinus venosus enlarges, the left horn and the body of the sinus venosus diminishes, so that the right horn of the sinus venosus will be incorporating to form the posterior smooth part of the right atrium. It will be called as the sinus venarum. The left horn and the body of the sinus venosus, which diminishes, will be giving rise to the coronary sinus.